Good afternoon, students. Today we are discussing our fifth chapter. This chapter is from part 2 textbook. Okay, the chapter name is acid, bases and salt. While telling the chapter name, what you are thinking? Yes, in this chapter we are studying the some nature of some chemicals, acidic, basic. So what do you mean by acidic? What do you mean by basic? In our daily life we are eating so many different foods, right, with different taste. Some are sweet, some are salty, some are sour, some are bitter, right? So how this is related with the our chapter? Are you remembering? Let us see some substances which are we are eating and their properties. Lemon juice, what is the taste of it? It is sour, right? What is the taste of orange? It is also sour. What is the taste of baking soda? It is light bitter. What is the taste of sugar? It is sweet. What is the taste of common salt? It is salty. What is the taste of curd? It is also a sour, right? So which are the substances which have the sour taste? Lemon juice, orange juice and the curd and tamarind and amla. These are the some substances which are the sour in taste, right? Why these substances are sour? Are you thinking about it? Yes, because these substances are sour in this acid is present. Because of that, these substances are sour in taste. The substances which taste sour is because of the presence of acids in it. The chemical nature of such substances are acidic. And if you consider baking soda, it is bitter in taste because in the baking soda acid is absent, so it is the bitter taste. And generally as we touch the baking soda, we feel a jelly like or we feel a soapy. The substances like bitter in taste and we feel soapy when we are touching, they are called as base, and their nature is basic. So now we studied the two type of substance. One is the acidic substance, another one is the basic substance. Acidic substance will have sour taste and basic substance will have bitter taste. The word acid comes from a Latin word called acere, which means that sour taste. So now we studied the tastes of some substance which we are using in our home or in our daily life and their nature, whether it is acidic or basic. Let us study some acids and bases which present in the substance which we are using in our daily life. Let us study some acids and bases which are present in substances which we are using in our daily life. Okay, now you can see a table, right? In that some acids are there and where they found, some substances are also there. Okay, the first acid is acetic acid and it is present in the vinegar. And formic acid, it is present in the ant's sting. Citric acid, it is present in the citrus fruits. Which are the citrus fruits? Lemon, orange, or any fruit with a sour taste. Okay. Lactic acid, it is present in the curd. And oxalic acid, present in the spinach. Ascorbic acid, present in the amla and also citrus fruit. And tartaric acid, present in the tamarind, grapes, unripened mangoes. In this, tartaric acid is present. Now you can see some bases, right? And where they formed. The calcium hydroxide, which was present in the lime water, and ammonium hydroxide, which is present in the window cleaner, and sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide, which is present in the soap. So, these are the some acids and bases present in the some substances. Now we told that by tasting or by taste we can say that it is an acid or base. But all the substances we cannot eat because in the chemistry, chemical laboratory is there. So in that acids are there, bases are there, salts are there. So how we can differentiate it? We cannot eat because it may be injurious to our health, right? Some acids are injurious to our health. So how we can identify whether it is an acid or base? For that, there are some substances which are called as indicators. Indicators are the substances which are used to identify whether a substance is acidic or basic. So, let us study some indicators with the experiments. Okay. The first one, litmus paper. There are two types of the litmus paper is there. One is red, another one is blue. So, are you see, right? Can you see the blue litmus paper and the red litmus paper? So, two types of the litmus paper are there. So, we can use this litmus paper to tell whether it is acid or base. Let us see how we can identify whether a substance is acidic or basic. Red litmus paper and it is a sodium hydroxide, that means it is a base. Now I am putting this red litmus paper to the solutions. Now I dipped this one. So what happened? The red litmus paper will convert into blue, right? Let us see the blue, what happens for the blue. So, it is a blue litmus paper. So, there is no color change, right? It is blue itself. So, in the basic, the red litmus will convert into blue. Let us check in the acid. It is a dilute acid, okay? Not the concentrated. For checking the nature, we can use the dilute acids. So, this is a red litmus paper. Now, I am putting this in the acid. So, here there is no color change. Okay. The red litmus paper acid cell. to get blue litmus paper. Now you can see the color change. It was converting to red light. Blue litmus paper will convert into red litmus paper in the acidic solution. And in the basic solution, blue litmus paper will convert into red. We can use litmus paper to identify the solution whether it is alkali or acidic. Alkali means basic itself. So we can test using a litmus paper whether the solution is acidic or basic. If the blue litmus will convert into red, then the solution is acidic. If the red litmus will convert into blue, then the solution is basic. Okay. Let us see another indicator. It is the phenolphthalein. So this phenolphthalein will not have any color. So now I am taking the basic solution, that is sodium hydroxide solution, in the test tube. Now I am putting a drop of phenolphthalein to the base. Let us see what happens. A drop of the phenolphthalein will change the color of the basic solution, right? So in the phenolphthalein, in the basic solution, it will give the pink color. Let us see in the acidic solution what happens. This is the dilute acid. No coloration, right? In the acidic solutions, the phenolphthalein will not give the color, but in the basic solution, it will give the pink color. Okay, so phenolphthalein can be used to find out the base, whether a substance is base. What happens while putting the phenolphthalein, the solution will convert into pink color. Okay, phenolphthalein does not have any color, but if you put a drop of phenolphthalein to the basic solution, then it will give a pink color, but in the acid, no color is there for the phenolphthalein. Okay, let us see another indicator. It is the methyl orange. So it is a methyl orange and it is orange colored solution. Okay, let us check the color of the methyl orange in the base. Now I took basic solution. Or it is a base. I am putting the methyl orange. See the color? Which is the color? Yeah, yellow color is there. Now I took acid. Let us see what is the color it gives. Yeah, red color, right? So methyl orange differentiate the acid and base, right? In the acid, it will give the pink color, and in the base, it will give the yellow color. It is a turmeric paper. It is made up of by taking a filter paper and by putting in the turmeric powder paste. Okay, so now let us check what is the color of the turmeric paper when it put in the acid and in the base? Now I am putting in the acid. No color changes there. It is yellow itself. This is the base, and now putting in the base. Now you can see the color change, right? The yellow color was converted into red. But by using the turmeric paper, we cannot identify the acid. In the acid, it itself gives the yellow color. In the base only, the color changes. Okay. And the last one, it is China rose petals. It is a natural rose which is in the China, and these petals can be used to find out whether the solution is acidic or basic. In the acid it will give the dark pink color, but in the base it will be green, but actually its color is light pink. Okay, so now we are seeing the five indicators, right? Which are they? Let us see. The first one is litmus paper, and the blue litmus paper will give the red color in the acidic solution, but the red litmus paper cannot give the blue color in the acidic solution, but red litmus paper will give the blue color in the basic solution only. Okay, and the next one is phenolphthalein, and the phenolphthalein is a colorless solution, but in the base it will give the pink color, but in the acid there is the no coloration. Okay, then third one, it is methyl orange, and the color of the methyl orange is orange. So in the acid it will give the red color, but in the base it will give the yellow color. And the fourth one, that is turmeric powder, and it is turmeric powder paper. Okay, it will be yellow in color, and it will convert into red when the solution is alkaline. And the China rose petals, so it is light pink color, but in the acid it will give the dark pink color, and in the base it will give the pink to green. And it is a China rose petal is a natural indicator which is occurring naturally, and others are which is man made indicators. Okay, litmus paper, phenolphthalein, methyl orange, and turmeric powder paper, this all are the made by man. And let us see some substances, whether they are acidic in nature or basic in nature. Okay, now I took a lime water. Let us say it is a acid or base. By taking the litmus paper, this is lime water. Now I taking a blue litmus paper. Let us see what happens. There is no change, right? Blue litmus paper will like that only. Now I take red. Let us see what happens. Here red litmus paper converted into blue, right? The color changes from red to blue. That means it is alkaline, right? In the alkaline, red litmus will convert into blue. So like this, alkaline in the nature. Now this is a soap water made from the exo soap. Let us see whether it is acidic or basic in nature. Okay, this is a red litmus paper. So let us say whether color changes or not. Yes, the red litmus will convert into blue, right? But the let us check what happens for the blue. It will be acid itself. That means soap contains the base or alkalis. If you check using other soaps also, you will get the solution is basic, because all the soap solutions are made from the sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide. Okay, let us check what happens to the HCl, already we are checked, but there is a table in your textbook to fill whether the red litmus paper convert into blue or blue litmus paper convert into red. It is dilute acid. Here blue will convert into red. That means it is acidic in nature. Red will acid itself. That means it is a acid, right? HCl is a acid, so it will not give the color change. The red litmus will not change its color. So soap solution and lime water, both are the alkaline. There is a table to fill you. It's a 5.1. Fill it. Lime water is an alkaline in nature and it will convert red to blue. But vinegar and HCl are acidic in nature and they will turn blue litmus to red litmus. Okay. And let us move to the next topic. When metal reacts with the acid, what happens? A highly reactive metal, it is a zinc or magnesium, was put in the HCl, or taking a zinc or the magnesium metal in a test tube and pour 2 ml of dilute HCl. What happens? You can see the some bubbles. If you take a matchstick and for and at the mouth of the test tube, what happens? It will burn with a pop sound. What we did, take a small piece of zinc and we poured the 2 ml of dilute HCl. Show a burning matchstick at the mouth of the test tube. What happens? It will burn with the pop sound. Why? It is because of hydrogen gases liberated from the solutions. Let us see the chemical equations, how the H2 was liberated. That is, if you take zinc, it was reacting with the HCl, will give zinc chloride and H2 gas. So here 2 hydrogen and 2 Cl are there, so we will put 2 here to balance the equation. So what happens? Zinc, it is a metal, when reacting with the acid, it will liberate the hydrogen gas. Because of this, when we take the matchstick to the mouth of the test tube, it will burn with a pop sound. So the only highly reactive metal give the hydrogen gas as a product. That means highly reactive means magnesium and zinc. It was there in the 10th standard, 3rd chapter, as clearly and detailedly. Now only one reaction is there for you. That is metal reacting with the acid, it will liberate the hydrogen gas. Let us see a video. Are you seen a video, right? In that, when the metal reacting with the acid, what happened? The hydrogen gas is liberated. Let us take another experiment. It is calcium carbonate. When reacting with the hydrogen chloride or HCl, what happens? It will liberate the carbon dioxide. And if you pass this carbon dioxide to the lime water, that lime water will convert into white. And in the lime water, you can see the white precipitate. Let us see a video.
One spatula full of calcium carbonate into the dilute hydrochloric acid. Okay, then place the stopper of the water test. Okay, you should get effervescence of carbon dioxide gas. KSD. So white precipitate forming in the lime water.
When acids are reacting with the carbonates, what happens? Carbon dioxide is liberated. Acid reacting with the carbonates will liberate the carbon dioxide. Okay? So now we studied the some properties of acids, right? Let us memorize it. Characteristic of acid. The first one, it turns the blue litmus paper into red. And the second one, acid reacts with the carbonates and liberates carbon dioxide. And acid reacts with the metal and liberates the hydrogen gas, but only the highly reactive metal. Okay, and this acid will have the soury taste. These are the properties which we are studied in this chapter. Okay, let us see the other properties and other details of the acids. Let us see the common component present in the acids. Which are acids you know? Yes, HCl, hydrochloric acid. And what is the other? That is sulfuric acid, H2SO4. Are you remembering, right? And the nitric acid, HNO3. And carbonic acid, H2CO3. And the phosphoric acid, H3PO4. Right. So, here you can see a common component, which is a hydrogen, right? When the ionization occurs, what happens? HCl, H plus Cl minus, right? Same as that in the sulfuric acid. 2 hydrogen is there, so 2H plus plus SO4, 2 minus. And HNO3, what is it? H plus plus NO3. And for the carbonic acid, 2H plus plus CO3, 2 minus. And for the H3PO4, 3H plus plus PO4, 3 minus. So these are the ionization of the acids. So all the acids are containing the same ion, which are the H plus, right? In all acids, H plus is there. So H plus is a common component present in the acid. So here HCl and gives the 1 H plus ion. So the acid which gives the 1 H plus is called as monobasic acid. And which gives the 2, it was called as dibasic acid. And which gives the 3H plus is called as tribasic acid. So monobasic means which gives the 1 H plus ion. Dibasic means which gives the 2 H plus ion. Tribasic means which gives the 3 H plus ions. Okay. The number of hydrogen ions that can be donated by one molecule of an acid is called its basicity. The number of hydrogen ions that can be donated by one molecule of an acid is called its basicity. Now the monobasic means its basicity is 1 and the dibasic means its basicity is 2 and the tribasic means its basicity is 3. And are you drinking the soda water, right? In the soda water, what is present? Which chemical is present? Or how soda water is prepared? Are you known? Yes, the soda water was prepared by using the water and carbon dioxide, that is H2O plus CO2 will give the soda water, that is carbonic acid H2CO3. The H2O CO2 will react to form the carbonic acid H2CO3. And what happens when the sulfur dioxide was dissolved in the water? Let us see the chemical equation H2O plus SO2. What may be the product? Are you thinking? Yes, it is H2SO3. And when the water reacting with the sulfur dioxide, the acid is H2SO3, or sulfur dioxide is dissolved in the water, it will give the H2SO3. It is also an acid, right, which contains the common component hydrogen or the H plus ions. And this H plus ions cannot be stay as itself, and it will react with the H2O molecule and form the H3O plus ions. And the H plus ions are there in the water as a H3O plus ions. Okay. So carbon dioxide and the sulfur dioxide and the NO2, nitrogen dioxide, these dioxides are non-metallic oxides. Sulfur oxide, carbon dioxide and nitrogen dioxides, these are the non-metallic oxides. Generally, compounds formed by the reaction of non-metallic oxides with the water are acidic in nature. Now you can see, this is the water and this is the non-metallic oxides. Reacting with both, it will give the acids. So these two will be acidic in nature, carbonic acid and also this H2SO3, that is sulfurous acid. So this is about the acids. Are you remembering about acid rain? How this acid rain was came? Here you can see an image, right? Yes, in this image some posters are there. Read it. Are you finished? What is it? Yes, acids of oxides such as sulfur dioxide and nitrogen dioxide, carbon dioxide are released into the atmosphere. From where? From the industries and from the vehicles. So what happens? These gases are carried by the wind. So what happens? These gases are dissolved in the rainwater, and while the rain coming, it was come as a acid rain, right? Why it was called as acid rain? The water which contains the acids, so it was called as acid rain. Let us see the definition of acid rain. In industrial areas or town areas, what happens? The chances of air pollution is more. So what happens? This NO2, CO2, SO2, all the gases will go to the atmosphere, and it was passed by the window, or wind will carry these gases to the rainwater, and it will dissolve in the rainwater. And what happens? this will come as a acid rain. In the rain water, the acidic nature will be there, or the for the water, rain water, it contains the acidic nature. So it was called as acid rain. So what is the cause of acid rain? It will destroy the greenery. This acid rain will destroy the greenery, and it will stop the formation of photosynthesis, or photosynthesis will not occur. So what happens? Carbohydrate will be not produced. When the carbohydrate was not produced, what happens? This all you studied in the biology, right? What happens? There is no the ripening of, or there is no the flowers or fruits in the tree. What happens? At last, tree will be dry, or there are no leaves, right? So greenery will be lost. Here you can see the some points about the problems of the acid rain, right? Which are they? Plants lost their ability to produce the carbohydrates through photosynthesis as their leaves are destroyed. Severe acid rain destroys the greenery of that region. And the last one, the acidic nature of water causes the death of and destruction of fish and also the corals. These are the problems of this acid rain. How we can reduce this acid rain? We should remove the acid content from water, right? How we can remove it? We should not use the fossil fuels. All the fossil fuels while burning will produce the carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide and NO2, nitrogen dioxide. And if we using the fossil fuel, just remove the sulfur content present in these fossil fuels. So what happens? Sulfur dioxide will be not there in the atmosphere. So what happens? There is no possibility of acid rain. This is all about acid rain. So in this chapter, in this video, we studied about acids and their characteristics and how we can find out whether it is acid or base, that is indicators. We studied the 5 types of indicators and some acids and the common component which is present in the acid and the basicity. So what do you mean by basicity? Basicity is the property of an acid which gives the number of H plus ions when it is ionizing. And there are monobasic, dibasic and tribasic. Monobasic means which gives the 1 H plus ions when it is ionizing, and dibasic means which gives 2 hydrogen ions, and tribasic means which gives the 3 hydrogen ions. And we studied how soda water was prepared, that is by the reaction of water and carbon dioxide soda water is prepared, and how acid rain came, and what is the problem of it, how we can reduce it. Study well. Thank you.